Yo, it's Mel from Rap Rankings. To hear the full episode this clip comes from and all the other episodes, stop by raprankings.com or search Rap Rankings on your favorite podcast platform. Track 2, Return of the Mac.
Parentheses, New York shit.
Yes, well, we back. We definitely back now. Flat 7.
8 minus, ding me baby.
Oh, look at that.
So, yeah. This is an independent album, so I'm going to tread carefully with my words here. I like this sample a lot.
Oh, No sample snitching, right?
Okay. Yeah, it's a sample from a blaxploitation movie. I won't say which one, but if you know, you know. You've got this sample of a rapper.
I don't feel good. Do you know what it is?
Yes, I do.
You should type it in the chat, because I don't feel good about you knowing this movie and me not knowing it, because you know.
And you ain't black.
I'm sure you
I should know what this is.
I'm sure you do.
Okay.
I'm putting it in the chat right now.
Can't let no white man know black movies. Oh! Okay. I know this. Yeah. All right.
So that's the sample. But then we have a sample, also a vocal sample of a prominent rapper, let's say. Also in the mix.
We can't say who the rapper is? I think it's kind of important because the rapper that sampled once had a bit of beef with this guy.
Yes, and he gets addressed later on in the album, so we'll talk about it then.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, can we really not talk about who the rapper is? Because I'm a big fan of the sample on this track.
Well, you can say the words, but you can't say the name of the artist.
Oh, brother. Okay. What do you say? All my niggas in the pen.
Here we go, again.
Ain't nothing separating us from a Mac 10. You know, okay. It's utilized well.
He takes, this is not an actual sample, so I'll just tell you, play that gun talk. It's definitely, you know, this is a classic freestyle from Biggie, the other half of the chorus, that he goes in right after that sample. You know, I got 11 Mac 11s, 38, 38s, 9-9s, 10 Mac 10s, the shit don't end. This is Notorious B.I.G. Gun Talk. This is the Green Lantern remix, but it's based on what I believe is called the Palladium Freestyle.
The Palladium?
The Palladium Freestyle by Biggie, yeah. Okay. It's a blend, but the verse is on here. You'll hear, you know, what he's interpolating.
All right, you said it's Gun Talk?
Yeah.
All right, well, here's a little of Gun Talk by Green Lantern. Flipping that big O, Biggie for the uninitiated. Here you go.
That's the sound of the man.
Green Lantern.
Damn, a nigga style is unorthodox.
Move over, y'all amateurs. Don't compare me to you, nigga. You ain't this. Whoa.
All I need in the size to sin.
There's a crooked lawyer, big rims, and a Mac 10.
That's how I do me. Do me.
Pull up and they turn.
Ride with
pull
up, does it burn?
There's a crooked lawyer, big rims, and a Mac 10.
The fifth got a rubber grip and a beam on it.
Hey, the evil genius.
Seven Mac 11s, about 8, 38s, 9-9s, 10 Mac 10s. The shit's never end. You can't touch my riches. Even if you had MC Hammer and them 357 bitches. Biggie Smalls, the millionaire, the mansion, the yacht. The two weed spots, the two hot blocks. That's how I got the weed spot. I shot Trent in the head, took the bread and the lamb's bread. Gotti got the shoddy to your body, so don't resist, or you might miss Christmas. I tote guns, I make number runs, I give MCs the runs dripping. When I throw my clip in
the- You know, it's been said before, but whenever I hear these Biggie blends that people make, it's obvious to me that he could have had a career long past the era that he was in, because he was one of them flowmeisters, you know, like he would have fit on any of these new age beats. He would have found a way. Okay. Biggie was a versatile dude. So that sounded like, you know, what happened to that boy. He could have definitely told us what happened to that boy.
You can put a lot of his verses, like his acapellas, on beats and they just sound great. Like in a way that sometimes you put other rappers on beats and it's like, this clearly sounds like a blend.
Right.
You know. But yeah,
that's what Prodigy interpolated.
He interpolated the 7 Mac 11s, 8 38s, 9 9s. I think that they used that. This is the acapella, not from the actual performance at the Palladium, but I think he recorded that verse. The song never came out. And then it was on Born Again, his posthumous album. And I don't think that that was like the song he made. I think the verse was recorded and they made the song around it. But call in 718-635-0743 if I got that wrong.
That's not the one that had Nasty Girl on it, is it?
Nasty Girl's on Life After Death, bro.
No, the Jagged Edge remix.
Oh, that's Biggie Duets.
Okay, there we go. Nasty Girl. That's a seventh grade male classic, anyway.
That might be the only good song on Biggie Duets, actually. No, there's like, to be fair, there's like three or four others, but it's not a very good album.
We gotta review it one day, right? Or do we have a rule against posthumous albums?
I don't think so, because we did the posthumous Gangstar album as a first listen.
But that was the first listen, though, you know?
Yeah, I don't like posthumous albums.
Me either. We've probably talked about it in the past. But
it depends on the level of involvement. Like, how complete was the album before it was put out?
If it was finished before the artist passed, then I consider it a part of their catalog. If it was like hobbled together after with scraps and like stems and stuff
and verses we've heard on other songs before, then get that out of here.
Yeah, but
and then for the verses, Prodigy interpolates a song that had come out a year earlier. We got this New York Shit by Busta Rhymes
in the folder. Okay.
So, Prodigy
was just on his, like, he was hyper New Yorked out.
No, the song New York Shit was kind of like, not like a big single, but it was released to the radio, especially, it got a lot of play in the tri-state area. So, New York Shit by Busta Rhymes was on the Big Bang album. And in the summer of 06, that was kind of not a big record, but it was a record in New York that got played quite a bit. So, this is him kind of like taking that flow and doing his own thing with it.
Got it. Right. Okay.
So here's that New York Shit by Busta Rhymes.
Featuring Swizz Beatz, huh?
Yeah, produced by DJ Scratch.
All right, here we go.
DJ Scratch, you sick for this one. This one. New York, come on, Swizzy. If you're from New York, stand up right now. If you're from New York, hands up right now. I'm a New York shit. I'm on my New York shit. Riding on the train, I'm a New York shit. Burning in the club, I'm a New York shit. Raising my mouth, I'm a New York shit. Yeah, I'm on my New York shit. Got the world following the New York script. Hustle with Timbs and hoodies on my New York flip. Rubber band stack money with my New York click. Yeah, I'm on my New York shit. I rep the Giants and Jets, New York Knicks. Tailor made clothing with my New York stitch. My chick beckons, don't you see my New York bitch?
R.I.P. to the New York Knicks. They ain't dead, but they just got hold again today.
Ugh, I don't want to talk about that.
I hate it. Look, they are the real team in New York. Okay, the Nets are fake. And another thing before I let you talk, when he said New York strip in the song, it reminded me. Cam, if you're listening, the father, Cam is like, I went to Texas Roadhouse, I think a couple weeks ago, and I tried the prime rib because I've been trying all the different cuts and varieties of meat. I've been trying them all. It was the first time I ever had prime rib. And, I trust you as a man of sports and food. We talk that fast food, that sports, the wrestling, all of it. Okay. And I just wanted to see if you had ever said anything about prime rib or Texas Roadhouse, I think. And so as I was eating the prime rib that night, I searched your timeline and there was one tweet and you specifically mentioned, hold on, I kept eating it. I actually rather enjoyed it. It was like
this man was stalking the father while he was eating a meal in his car.
No, it was just, I wanted to see what he thought because I trust his opinion.
You ever see that Nightcrawler with Jake Gyllenhaal?
That's a good film. But no, I wasn't on that Nightcrawler.
That's you.
Okay.
Sitting in that
I wasn't Jake Gyllenhaal. Where is it? Trimer. Okay. April 20th, 2016. So I was sitting here at this very desk eating this thing, and I see this tweet that you tweeted at somebody. You said, I can't imagine eating prime rib from Texas Roadhouse. That sounds like C-grade beef happening. And I'm just sitting here mid-chew like, oh, word?
You got to break out of this prime rib at Texas Roadhouse.
Australian, it was the first time I ever had it. I was just trying it for the first time.
We got this man's eating Wagyu and flyover states. We got to save this man.
Oh, no. You know what I just realized? Do I sound different?
Yeah, a little.
I had my mic turned up.
Your shit was kind of loud, though. I actually had to turn my headphones down a little bit because I'm like, this motherfucker is loud tonight.
Yeah, uncharacteristically loud.
I guess Moulz McVirgin and Mel the Albert Man or something.
They've been knocking something around.
They must have been fucking messing with our mics or something.
They were clearly like under the influence of something. So I think they've been stumbling around.
Weed, which I heard them do live on the fucking show.
Yeah. You know, weed and sniffing panties and... They think we're bad guys. Look at those people. But yeah, anyway, Cam, I won't eat it again from there because I know now that there are better places to get it. But I enjoyed it. 8-7+. Anyway, New York strips and prime ribs aside, you know, on the topic of New York, I wanted to propose this to you, Moulz, because this is kind of what I got from it. As much as this is about the return of the Mac gun and whatnot, this whole album kind of feels it's as much. Oh, maybe not a love letter, but just a letter to New York, you know, because it's mentioned. New York's mentioned a lot throughout this album, you know. You know,
well, I was saying, in
do you
part
consider
one,
this
time,
to be like a?
Yeah, every time I go back home, I'm always playing this and HNIC Part 2 and HNIC 1.
Okay,
they feel like home to me, and I really it's crazy. It's like. As good as, like, some of that, like, DJ Quick and stuff is living in L.A. Mm-hmm. and, like, hearing that music while you, you know, drive through basically the places that it was made.
Right.
There's something that feels like home about Mobb Deep and Prodigy, but Prodigy's solo music for me especially. Like, it feels like home more than anything else. So, I mean... In a way, yeah, it's definitely like a... I feel like a lot of his music is that way, though.
Yeah.
Especially if you're from Queens or if you're from Long Island and, you know, the amount of times he talks about both places, it's, you know, if you're from there, you have a lot of pride for the music that comes out of there.
We all know Mel ain't from New York, but I was feeling a sense of pride. That was the word vicariously, I guess. Like, listening to this... You know, it's like orange box cut of that New York shit. Guzzle the whole bottle. That's a New York sip.
My baby mom's from Brooklyn. My New York bitch got that coke on Broadway. That New York flip. Hose down south. Hose down my south. New York accent. So this is what I want to talk about a little bit. This is what I call like second wave Prodigy. So he kind of slowed down and got more methodical at a point. Like,
okay,
it might have been during like the HNIC1 era, like 2000 maybe, because he was rapping on there. At points, it's reminiscent of the first three Mobb Deep albums, but at other points, it's reminiscent of what was to come, and it's a slower, more methodical, but to me, more emotional style and funnier style of rapping, It's a dark sense of humor, and there's also a lot more emotional weightiness that comes to it. So it's like, you know, hose down south, love my New York accent, and cheat on a man for some New York dick. Like, the way he'd break up words sometimes on this album, the way that he'd rhyme the same word with the same word, you know, it's like these weren't things that he was doing on The Infamous. You notice on The Infamous, he's more... I would say flexible.
Okay.
He's rapping with more fluidity, but the bars to me don't cut as deep. So him slowing it down, I think of it like, slow down, kid, work a hold, you know?
Right.
Like, he's working holds at this stage in his career. His style has shifted from, like, third gear to second gear, but it's enhanced certain things about him as well.
Mm-hmm.
So, on its face, some of it might come off more, like, simplistic or, like, brash or to the point. But that is the point, I believe.
Do you think perhaps, like, maybe, you know, it's from due to proximity to 50 at all? Like,
Good question.
Maybe could have influenced it a bit?
Potentially. Like, refine the style, but it was before he got involved with 50 that it really started. Like,
okay.
Kind of on Keep It Thorough, his debut solo single from the first HNIC album, there's some structuring of bars and some delivery on that song that bring to mind this style as well. So it was pre-50. Maybe he picked up other things from 50, though, I imagine. But I like this slower, more methodical style from him as well. Like,
got it.
I think of Master Ace as well, right? Like,
oh, yeah.
Master Ace in his earlier days, when it was like Sitting on Chrome a little bit, but that's like the bridge album for him, where like things kind of shift after that. Slaughterhouse, Take a Look Around, early Master Ace, Master Ace Incorporated, all that stuff. He's rapping a lot faster on the earlier songs. By the time I get really put on to Master Ace and I hear Disposable Arts and A Long Hot Summer, he's rapping slower than he did on the older albums. But again, there's something different now. The style of production is a little bit different. There's things that are being enhanced that were previously, I suppose, like, not really present because of the style he was using earlier. And, you know, you're able to slow down, work a hold, tell a story, essentially.
There might be some parallels with, like, you know, great sports figures who, you know, as they get older, they may not be as athletic, but they find new ways to perform. You know,
yes.
It's like Jordan, when he got older, he wasn't, you know, flying around the court dunking on everybody. He started working that fadeaway.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like, it could be a similar thing with rap, where it's like, you know, maybe you're not as technical anymore, but like the bars get stronger. You pick your spots.
Look how Cam'ron used to rap.
Right.
Cam'ron used to rap like DMX meets Nori.
Yeah. And then eventually he was getting computers putin', you know?
Yes. So, but that was a dope era in and of itself. We never thought he fell off.
It's a new way to score.
Yes.
You know?
And to me, that only adds to, like, that checks off a box, in my opinion, because you can either become diminishing returns or fall off, or you can evolve stylistically without changing your genre. You know, sometimes people think musical evolution sort of boils down to, I'm just going to start singing now, or like, this is going to be like, you know, electro EDM music or whatever. Like, it doesn't have to be that. You can change up your whole style and approach. I think of AG, of Showbiz and AG. He used to rap, like, he would rap on, like, faster tempo beats. Now he raps over, you know, he was one of the original drumless beats guys in 2010. He put out Everything's Barry, and then ever since then, he's put out a lot of music with this producer, Ray West, who makes a lot of, I would say, like, drumless or drumless adjacent sort of music. So you got to adapt your style as a rapper as you age.
Speaking of drumless beats, I mean, this is a drumless beat. It's Return of the Mac, right? I mean,
hard to say.
It was drumless to me. I didn't hear no added.
I'm familiar program. With the original sample enough to say, like, if there's something that's done, maybe it's an EQing change.
Okay.
Where like the sort of like the lows and the mids might be enhanced.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, there's certainly like more noticeable programming across other songs in this album. And then there's other songs where there's not a noticeable amount of programming. That's why I question it. Because like, for example, Mac 10 Handle, which we'll get to soon. That's a song where it is heavily leaning on the sample, but there is additional like drum fills put in there, I think, just to modernize it a little bit.
Okay. You would know more than me. We can't, and in the sample, we can't talk about it. All right?
We can talk around it.
Yeah, we can talk around it. You know?
But yeah, I mean, it's a good record because I think like it gets you hype for this album. It has energy to it. The music's cinematic, and you know, it's like we get hit, you know, the end, the little like the samples kind of riding out a little bit, and then you get the Alchemist tag, that Alchemist. You know, you're just ready. You're ready to hear more at this point.
Well, I want to say, just back on that New York a bit. What I appreciate is, you can confirm this for me. One, when he says NYPD, New York Pricks and Dicks, is that kind of a local thing?
I mean, I've heard it, but okay. I've heard Prodigy say it more than anybody on planet Earth.
Oh, so this could be a Prodigy original is what you're saying.
Maybe passed down.
Okay. Got it. Yeah, there's a line here shortly after that. I'm trying to make 100 mil. That's New York rich. Well, my thought was that might be rich anywhere, Prodigy. I mean, but maybe he's saying, you know, cost of living. You know, New York, like California, like it's one of those areas. Is that what he means? Like,
well, I think also, like, there's a lot of people in New York who have a couple million. But so right. New York,
you
like,
know, so it's one of those places where, like, you got to really stand out.
Yeah, you got to have more than just, like, I guess a couple million to stand out as like, oh, they're one of the rich people of New York, you know?
Listen, I'm trying to be Peoria rich, okay? That's probably what, like 50K?
I think it's probably just like 50 more patrons.
Oh, man. Usually I'm the one begging for money. But y'all heard Moulz, all right? More patrons. More patrons, more problems. There you go. I like how he ends breaking the rhyme, but like, what do you say? Like, you know, and get killed by a New Yorker.
New Yorker. Yeah. He said,
yeah, it's a great thematic conclusion there.
Every hoe want to know who the New York kid with the New York plates on the bulletproof truck better chill or get killed by a New Yorker.
That's how it ends. It's good. I like that. Okay. A very New York song. Apparently he was, you know, borrowing from some recent songs at the time.
Yes.
Some samples from a dude he used to beef with. Some samples from a blaxploitation. Well, is this film blaxploitation? Or yeah, is it just a black take on?
No, it's considered blaxploitation. Especially, you know, the sequel had Pam Grier in it. You guys should be able to put it together by now if you know a thing or two.
I mean, she was in a lot of stuff.
It's part of the Soul Cinema Blaxploitation DVD collection.
Okay.
Trust me, it's blaxploitation.
Okay. I'm looking it up. No, I've definitely seen this. Was there a sequel to this?
Yes, with Pam Grier. That's what I was saying.
Oh, right. You were saying, okay, I think I saw the sequel. It was like on TV or something.
The sequel is better than the original, in my opinion. Okay. But the soundtrack to the original is far superior to the sequel's soundtrack.
Wait, maybe Moulz, you had me watch it.
I think I did. I think I had you watch
that's the where sequel. I remember. It wasn't no TV. It was Moulz TV. Okay. Shout out to this film. Anyway. Yeah, my last thought, speaking of Moulz, this whole song, all the mentioning of New York in this beat, I said, Mel's wacky scenario. See, you're not going to get this because you're not a weeb. But I said, Moulz stomping around to this song like an Ozaru after staring at a New York moon. And Mel's got to cut his New York tail off to save the city from being destroyed.
Can I get the future? Can I get the future? Whatever that fucking means.
Yeah, you can. But look, my nerds, they know what that. They know what just happened. Okay, they know what just happened.
And whatever that fucking means.
Okay, we're moving on. Don't do that. Are we done here?
Yeah.
Yo, it's Mel from Rap Rankings. To hear the full episode this clip comes from and all the other episodes, stop by raprankings.com or search Rap Rankings on your favorite podcast platform.